Okay, so in the last class we studied about resources and classification. Then we saw the location of industry, where industry should be located, right? Then we studied importance of industries, where it provides employment, it provides basic materials or basic utility things, right? Then we saw that how it contributes in the national income. Right, then we saw the location of industries, classification of industries, right, those things were there. Now we are at page number 65, last paragraph, that is agro-based industry. So in the beginning I told you that industries are basically two types, agro-based industries and mineral-based industries, okay. So first we are going to study about the agro-based industries. So as the name suggests, agro-based means the raw material coming from agriculture, right, so that is called agro-based. So cotton, jute, silk, woolen textile, sugar, edible oil are based on the agricultural raw material. That is why it is called agro-based industries. Now you can see here one flow chart is given here. Fiber production takes place. It is about the textile one, okay, textile industry. Textile industry is very important here in India because they grow cotton, number one. Okay, and this is one of the ancient industries because since ancient time we have been producing textile and it was worldwide, it was sold. And our textile industry was so famous throughout the world that the Britishers sometimes in 1800 they had to impose heavy tax on British clothes in England so that people could be discouraged to buy Indian textile and they should buy the mill produced British textile. Okay, so we are going to study about first the textile one. And another one thing is that textile industry is the largest employment giver industry in India as per the book. So the textile industry occupies unique position in Indian economy because it contributes significantly to industrial production, employment generation and foreign exchange earnings because we export it, okay, and we have been exporting it since ancient time. So it is the only industry in the country which is self-reliant and compete in the value chain, that is from raw material to highest value added product. So what is value chain? That means from the raw material. You can see the flow chart here, that how it starts. So fiber production takes place, then spinning takes place, then weaving and knitting takes place, dyeing and finishing, then garment manufacture, okay, all these things take place. So raw fiber to yarn, yarn to fabric, fabric to garment, okay. So this is the process of, you can say, textile. This one, now we are talking about, let's say, cotton textile. So cotton textile, since ancient, the first trace of cotton textile we found in Indus Valley civilization. It was stuck in a pitcher, you can say the mud pitcher, and from there we got to know that the Indus Valley civilization people also knew about textile. And if you see the location of Indus Valley, it was in Pakistan and our Gujarat, Rajasthan and Haryana area. Right, there we grow cotton because Maharashtra and Gujarat are the big producer of cotton. So naturally cotton was known to them and they knew how to make clothes from there, right? Okay, and since then you can see that since ancient time, even the Romans and the during the medieval time also, cotton textile was one of the biggest export item from India. And you can see the diversity in cotton textile, that every state has its own textile. Okay, you have you heard of chicken?
Sir?
Chicken cloth.
No.
No, really? There are two types of chicken in India. One we eat and one we wear. Okay, have you seen me wearing a white kurta in school, ISA?
Yes.
Yeah, that was chicken, where we had all over the embroidery and all these things. Okay, that was chicken, which we wear, not eat. Okay, so that chicken is from UP, then Tamil Nadu, or you can say South India has its own, you can say Kanjivaram and many other types of textile we make over there. Then in Rajasthan, another one, Gujarati, Patola, Alag, yeah, that is a different one. Then we have in Maharashtra, then Bengali silk, Assam silk, Odia silk, lot many. That means every state has its own silk industry, or you can say textile industry, and they are peculiar. If you talk about undivided India, Bengal, that means Bangladesh, modern Bangladesh and our West Bengal, that was the hub of textile, and they used to have the finest quality of textile. That I'm talking about cotton textile, that was called malmal. Okay, textile in the world, and it used to be so thin that a huge chunk of cloth can be passed through a ring, right? So they were so expert in making cotton textile that without any machine, you know, that was handloom. So that is our history. And I tell you that Indian textile was so popular in Europe that people almost had, you can say, rejected the industrial textile from England, right? So the British government did what? That they imposed 4 pound, just considered around 200 years ago, 4 pound tax on any Britisher who is using Indian textile. Okay, 4 pound, that used to be a big, huge amount that time. Okay, penalty was imposed on that, fine you can say. And to discourage the Indian export to England, they imposed heavy tariff, that means you can say the custom barrier, so that anyone who is importing Indian textile in England, they have to pay a huge tax. Okay, you are allowed to import, but you have to pay a huge tax. In that case, naturally, what will happen? The textile will be expensive. It is expensive, then it will be sold expensive. If it is expensive, then people will definitely not buy, or very few people will buy, and they will be bound to pick up the mill-made clothes, right? So this was the history of, you can say, Indian textile. Okay, so coming back to cotton textile here. In ancient India, cotton textile were produced by hand spinning and handloom weaving technique. After the 18th century, that means after 1700 plus, power loom came to India. Our traditional industries suffered a setback during the colonial period because they could not compete with the mill-made cloth from England. So when the Britishers, see, ironical thing I tell you, that the Britishers or the Europeans invented textile machines, but you see that they did not grow textile because of the climatic condition, geographical condition, right? So they needed raw material. Raw material used to come from Egypt and India, that means Indian subcontinent I'm talking about. Okay, so because of the tropical climate, we were the best quality cotton grower in the world. And from there, the cotton as a raw material was exported to, or let's say imported to England. And from there, it was processed, or you can say textile was made in Indian, British industries. And from there, that used to come to India. So India became basically a supplier of raw material. Okay, especially cotton and sugar. Okay, that happened. So because sugar also is a tropical crop, and it was not grown in European countries. So that was the condition over there. So to make sure that the Indian textile, British textile is sold in India, first of all, they had to destroy our ancient handloom culture, or you can say the ancient cotton industry, right? And they destroyed it by not supplying raw material such as cotton, then imposing a lot of taxes and all these things. So people felt that it is not possible for them to continue in this business. So they left it, and they became landless laborer, or you can say the bandits and other things. Eventually, many of the traditions died down also. Okay, so now as a customer, you will see that if you get a cheaper cloth, naturally people will buy. Doesn't matter what country you belong to. So the British mill-made goods were, or you can say the clothes were so cheap that Indian textile suffered a setback, because when you are having handloom and all that takes time to make clothes, and naturally that will be a little expensive, right? So as a customer, if I go to a market and I see that one is Indian textile, which is expensive, and one is mill-made textile, British textile, right? Naturally, I will pick up the British textile because it is cheaper, right? And in that case, what happened that our textile could not compete with that British made goods, right? And demands started going down. So that is the condition, that was the condition. Now here two bullets are there. The first successful textile mill was established in Mumbai in 1854. See, 1854, 1853, 1854, 1855, you will see that in these 3 years, lot many things took place. The introduction of railway in India, 1854. mill, textile mill, jute mill, all these started in these 3-4 years. Okay, so these 3-4 years are very important. And after that, 1857 revolt also took place. Okay, we are not talking about a revolt here, but if you talk about industries, 53, 54, 55, one of these three years are very big. So the two world wars were fought in Europe. In Europe, India was a British colony. There was a demand for cloth in UK. Hence, they gave a boost to the development of the cotton textile industry. Can you tell me how demand for cloth in during World War got a boost? How?
For army uniforms?
Yeah, uniforms, then you need tents, then you need boots, right? For boots also you need the coarse clothes, okay? That kind of thing. Then lot many things, the bags and all, a variety of things are made of clothes, right? So naturally cloth, and on top of that you will see that export of raw material during the World War could not take place. That's my, suppose cotton is going for, let's say, transported from India to England. Because of the World War, the ships are sunk or the trade routes are disturbed and it was not safe, right? In that case, the raw material could not reach England. So where will the cloth be made? So better to make in the indigenous countries, or let's say the Indian or Egyptian mills. Okay, so we are talking about India. So in India, this is how the industrial you can say development took place. Okay, further it says, in the early years the cotton textile industry was concentrated in the cotton growing belt in Maharashtra and Gujarat. Availability of raw cotton markets, transport including accessible port facilities, labor, moist climate, etc. contributed towards its localization. Now you will see, this is what I was talking about, that every state had its own peculiar thing. If you talk about UP, and I was talking about chicken, right? UP does not grow, as far as I know, it does not grow so much of cotton. Okay, a little bit belt we have, right? Then also chicken industry is there. Okay, chicken textile I'm talking about. In Bengal, in Bihar, we have Bhagalpur silk. In Bengal, we have Bengali silk, Tassar silk, so many types of silk, okay? So that is, this is how the localization start. In the print also, that means you can say this is Rajasthani print, this is Gujarati print, this is Kanjibaram or South Indian print, right? So this is how we started localization of, you can say, textile. Plus, what are the other inputs you need, or what are the factors? Availability of raw material, that means raw cotton. Then you need market, okay? Then transport. Because of transport, it doesn't matter that where the raw material are grown, or it can be transported in any part of the country, and there the local methods and the local technique can be used to produce different kind of textile, right? That happened. This industry has close links with agriculture and provides a living to the farmers, cotton ball pluckers, the workers engaged in gaining, spinning, weaving. You must have studied in grade 8 social studies, I think, where the process of textile was given. Okay, dyeing, designing, packing, tailoring and sewing, all these things are. So you can understand that how many people get employment in that. That is why I told you that textile industry is the largest employment giving industry. Okay, so from the farmer to the tailor, okay, all gets this thing employment because of textile industry. All right, now these things are little dying down because people are now moving from the tailor to the ready-made garments, right? Okay, people hardly buy, or very few people buy clothes from the clothes shop, and they go to the tailor to get it stitched. Okay, mostly we go to the shop, or you can say the mall, or somewhere ready-made clothes we buy. We have branded companies to provide us trousers, shirts and all these things, right? Okay, so that's a different story. Otherwise, it anyway, whoever is stitching, naturally, if people are stitching for, let's say, industry also, or for a particular company also, naturally the clothes will be stitched, right? Suppose just consider I was a tailor, right? And I had my own tailor shop. Right, people used to come for stitching and all these things. Now nobody comes, or very few people come. So I close down the shop. This does not mean that my employment is gone. I can join the textile industry, or you can say the fashion companies, right? and for them I can stage, right? This is how it is. That means outsourcing can be done. You see, you need, what do you want?
What could I do?
Go start maths, grade 4, come on. Lesson 1. So you see Uniqlo, if you go to GU or Uniqlo, and if you check the tag, you will find made in Bangladesh, made in Indonesia, made in India. These type of shirts and you will find over there, you know. Now, so what are they doing? They are basically outsourcing. They are outsourcing these things because, of course, Japan doesn't grow cotton. They cannot have the cotton shirts and all these things. So where are these things coming from? These coming from there only. So they are outsourcing the things. Okay. So they specifically give their specification that this should be the quality of the cloth. Then this should be the size and design and all these things, okay. And the people in Bangladesh or in India, in Sri Lanka, or you can say in Indonesia, they stitch, and Uniqlo brings them back to Japan and it sells. This is how, okay. So while spinning continues to be centralized in Maharashtra, Gujarat and Tamil Nadu, weaving is highly decentralized to provide scope for incorporation of traditional skills and design of weaving in clothes, silk, jewelry, embroidery, etc. So if you see the Indian traditional dress which you wear in a festival and all these things, they have a distinct design. Okay, Rajasthani print, Gujarati print, then South Indian prints, then Kashmiri prints, or you can say Northeast states have different, you can say, prints and all these things. So when you see those clothes, you can figure out that which state it belong to. So now this is how you can see that how peculiar or how unique taste, or you can say design and diversity we have in the country in terms of textile production. Okay. So not only I'm talking about the textile production, I'm talking about the designing, then the color, the color combination or all these things. Have you heard of batik?
No, sir.
Batik is basically a local cotton textile and color design of Indonesia. I am big fan of batik clothes. Okay. And it's very cool in summer. And the colors are so good that my wife, which we brought clothes from Indonesia when we came in 2014 from there, still she is wearing those clothes and color has not faded. And it is so good. It is so good. Okay. So you can see not only textile doesn't have its own, you can say, characteristic. The characteristics and the other values are added, you know, country by country or state by state. Okay, so I'm at the second column. While spinning continues to be centralized in Maharashtra and all, right, weaving is highly decentralized to provide a scope for incorporating traditional skills and designing of weaving in cloth, cotton, silk, jewelry, embroidery, etc. India has world-class production in spinning, but weaving supplies low quality of fabric. Underline this sentence. India has world-class production in spinning, but weaving supplies low quality of fabric as it cannot use much of the high quality yarn produced in the country. Weaving is done by handloom, power loom and in mills. So basically what happens that high quality yarns are exported to other rich countries where they can afford. Okay. So in India, basically we do not use, or later we import them. So this is how it works. That means weaving supplies low quality of fabric as it cannot use much of the high quality yarn produced in the country because it will be expensive. If it is expensive, naturally people may not buy. Okay. So in that case, we use low quality, or you can say medium quality of yarn. The hand-spun khadi provides large scale employment to weavers in their homes as a cotton industry. So khadi is the cloth, or you can say a very coarse kind of, now it has become quite sophisticated also, and wearing khadi cloth is quite expensive these days. Okay, but it's a fashion trend. So you can say in recent 25 years or 20 years, governments in India have made khadi a brand. Okay, khadi, and the cloth and the textile or the varieties were added in khadi. Okay, and this because it is a cotton cottage industry. Okay, and cotton industry means that everybody gets employment if it is produced in the house or in the cottage, right? This was done by Gandhi. Gandhi, of course, you know that lay emphasis on spinning yarn and weaving khadi. Why? Because it provides employment. Okay, every house has an industry basically. So this is what his idea was for employment. So it says here that why did Mahatma Gandhi lay emphasis on spinning yarn and weaving khadi? Because of employment. Okay, and of course it's a constructive work. It's not a destructive work. It's a constructive work. So that has an aesthetic sense also. So write down there. That has an aesthetic sense, plus of course it's a constructive work, right? And it provides employment every house. Further it says, why is it important for our country to keep a mill sector loomage lower than power loom and hand loom? Okay, so it says, why is it important for our country to keep the mill sector loomage lower than power loom and hand loom? Mill sector, of course, see, mill sector, we have now automatic machines, right? Machines are automated now. So one person or two person handles lot many looms, okay, maybe hundreds or 50, because most of the things are computerized. So there the employment scope is less. Okay, that's why it says that if you want to provide employment in the country, right, you should have the mill sector loomage less, okay, than the power loom and hand loom. Power loom does not mean that power, it of course it runs through power, that means energy, electricity and all, but it is set up in the house itself, right? So people, those who have power loom, just consider that I am a weaver, I initially had a hand loom, that means it was run by hand, right? So all the family members were there doing that work. Now because of electricity and all these things, now we have the motor driven loom. But of course, it is in the house only. So everybody, you can say in the family, you get employment, you get a regular source of income. This is what it says here. Okay. Now, because of competitive market, if you talk about the world market or the globalized market, and you have a lot of competition. Earlier, we had the self-sufficient economy. That means we hardly needed anything from other countries. We were so self-sufficient. We had, that was called self-sufficient economy, and even the villages in India had self-sufficiency. People in the villages until you can say 1850 or you can say 1900 hardly used to go to the town. Why? Because most of the things were produced there within the village only. There was a weaver who used to supply clothes for everyone. There was a barber, there was a potter, there was a carpenter, right? Most of the things there used to be in the village itself. So they hardly needed to go out of the village to buy anything from the town, right? So this was the condition there, right? That also was, you can say, one of the negative points for the Britishers, that how the product will be sold, right? So they had to destroy our, you can say, the handloom and you can say the self-sufficient economy, so that people should be forced out to go to the town to buy the British made goods or the imported goods. Okay, that was the case. Further it says here, India exports yarn to Japan. Other importance of cotton goods from India are USA, UK, Russia, France, East European countries, Nepal, Singapore, Sri Lanka and African countries. So you can see that network, or you can say the areas where we export our cloth, or you can say the yarn. So we have a large share in the world trade of cotton yarn. Yarn and textile are two different things. Yarn, that means we have, you can say, wait a minute. I show you what is meant by just Google. Okay, so I give you now a picture of this one, very chat, yeah. So you can, this is called yarn. Okay, so this is kind of yarn, that means it's a thread. With that thread, the different countries with their technology, they make variety of things. So they mix many of the things, and this is how they make variety of clothes. So India exports, let's say, yarn to Japan, okay, and cotton goods means of course yarn and other things to USA, UK, that means European countries and all these things. We have a large share in the world trade of cotton yarn. Our spinning mills are competitive at the global level and capable of using all the fibers we produce. The weaving, knitting, and processing units cannot use much of the high quality yarn that is produced in the country. There are some large and modern factories in these segments. So high quality yarns are, mostly not used in India, as I told you earlier also, okay, because of technology and because of the expensive, or you can say the cost wise, that one. Anyway, we will discuss further. Now you can see the next page is about, you can the map of India, and it says India textile industry. So the distribution of textile industries in India, here you can see, right? And if you see the legend, it says the black dot is for cotton textile, then red one is for wooden textile, then another one, the black one, is for silk textile. So you can say almost throughout the country we have, you can say, textile industry, except Chhattisgarh, and this is Eastern belt. Okay, we have mostly there. Most of the things are there. Okay, so this is the distribution of, you can say, cotton industry in India. Further, it says page number 68. So here, okay, let's continue from page number 66. So it says that the weaving, knitting, and processing unit cannot use much of the high quality yarn that is produced in the country. There are some large and modern factories in this segment, but most of the production is in fragmented small units which cater to the local market. This mismatch is a major drawback of the industry. That means we do not have coordination. Okay, here we lack some coordination between varieties of agencies and variety of, you can say, the segments of cotton textile. So, and because of that, this happens. So further, it says this mismatch is a major drawback for the industry. As a result, many of our spinners export cotton yarn, while apparel or garment manufacturers have to import fabric. So we sent yarn, and from there it comes in the form of fabric. That means we import, okay, we import fabric and we export yarn, right? So that's a problem. So this happens. So why this happens? This happens because of not having good technology. Then you can say not having market, or you can say not having the proper coordination, right? So here it says, one example is given. Suppose that yarn is sold at 85 rupees per kg. If it is sold as a trouser, it fetches 800 rupees per kg. So value is added at every stage, from fiber to yarn to fabric and to garment. Okay, so this is how it works. So naturally, when, let's say, if a farmer grows wheat, what is the price of 1 kg wheat? Maybe 20 rupees, right? But when it becomes atta, of course, since value is added, so now it is expensive. Let's say 30 rupees. When it becomes biscuit, okay, further expensive. If it becomes cake or the bread, further expensive. So this is how it works. Okay, so at every stage, when you add value, naturally the price will be more. Okay, a log of wood has very low price, but when it is cut into slabs, okay, then it has further more price. But when from that those wooden slabs, if you make a table, it has different price. When polishing and other things are done, right, it has a different price. So every stage, when you add value in a particular product, right, the price is more. So here in India, we grow cotton, we export yarn and fabric and other things, or the garment we import from other countries. Why? Because of having good R&D, research and development, good technology, all these things. Okay, so here it says, next question, next is, why is it important for us to improve our weaving sector instead of exporting yarn in large quantity? So because export, when we so we when we export yarn, we get less money because value is not added. But when we import the fabric or other things, the garment or apparel, naturally, since value has added, the design has been different, the color has been different, the texture is different. So because of those things, what happens that, what do you say, value is added, so it becomes expensive. Have you heard of wrinkle free shirts or wrinkle free trousers?
Yes.
Yeah, so what happens in that? Basically, technology is used, okay, and they have their own raw R&D, research and development, and because of that, they've mixed with that yarn something, okay, which makes it you can say wrinkle free. Alright, okay, so the value, when the value is added, naturally it is expensive. So when we buy trousers in India and all, if it is wrinkle free, naturally it is going to be very expensive. Okay, so you do not have to do ironing every time you are washing, or let's say after every use. Even the cloth is not dirty, then also because of sitting and all these things, lot many wrinkles are there, so you need to iron again. Right, so this is not done. That is why people mostly don't wear, and some clothes need a lot of maintenance. So this is the maintenance. That means every time you have to do ironing and all, tight ironing. So people say, who has time? So jeans and other things have started coming up, or the synthetic fibers. Okay. Although we have made significant increase in the production of good quality long staple cotton, the need to import is still felt. That means demand is so much that we grow long thread. That means the cotton has, you know, the thread, you can say it's quite long. Long does not mean that you have a meter long or 10-15 centimeter. Considerably, it is okay, good quality, right? Then also we need to import. Power supply is erratic and machinery needs to be upgraded in the weaving and processing sector in particular. So these are the problems. These are the negative things. That means this is the area where we have to improve. So if the power supply is erratic, if you consider that you have a 10 power looms in your factory, okay, and let's say 10 people are working, and because of the power cuts, 3-4 hours power cuts or 6 hours power cut, the your laborers or your workers are sitting idle, you have to pay. But you see the output. What is the output? 6 hours they did not work. Why? Because there was no power. Okay, to make them work, if you are using, let's say, diesel generator and all these things, naturally your cost of production will be high. So if the cost of production is high, naturally you will not sell it at lower price, or in the market you find a stiff competition, because the other products, or you can say the same type of product in the market, is at a lower price. Why? Because there, in those countries, like say in China or even say other countries, power cut was not there, right? Okay, and they produce the things which cost less, okay, much lesser than your production cost. So in that case, you are simply thrown out of the market. That means the competitive market, you cannot be sold, because you don't want to sell at a loss. So in that case, it's not competitive. So if you work on these things, that means the machines are upgraded. That means you buy latest technology machine, okay, if power supply is good, then things may change. Other problems are the low output of labor and stiff competition with the synthetic fiber industry. Okay, our laborers do not produce that way the others, because of course we, you know, what to say, hardworking, you can say, not much trained, not so much dedicated, or all these things are there. Okay, with our laborers, one thing. Second one is say that synthetic fiber industry is more durable than you, and less maintenance it needs. So because of that also we have problem. So these are the, you can say, the drawbacks, okay, are there we have to work on. All right, so that was for cotton industry. Now we come to jute textile. So jute, it says that India is the largest producer of raw jute and jute goods, that stands at second place as an exporter after Bangladesh. So as I told you earlier, that jute, West Bengal and Bangladesh, when we were united, right, that time that was the major jute producing area after partition of India with East Pakistan and West Pakistan and India, right? Large amount of land went to Bangladesh, right? So that was another setback for us for jute industry. So here it says the first jute mill was set up in near Kolkata in 1855. So that's why I told you that 53, 54, 55 is very important for us. Okay, after partition in 1947, the jute mills remained in India, but 3/4 of the jute producing area went to Bangladesh, okay, erstwhile East Pakistan. So that was another setback for us. So factors responsible for their location in the Hooghly Basin. So if the question comes, let's say that what are the factors why jute is produced only in that pocket of the Indian subcontinent, not everywhere. It is not so that jute is not produced in Bihar or Odisha or West Bengal. It is produced, but majority is in Bangladesh. Okay, so it says proximity of jute producing area. Jute industries are, you know, located why? Because jute producing area is there, that area. Then inexpensive water transport. That means the water transport is not much expensive. Supported by good network of railways, roadways, waterways to facilitate movement of raw material to the mills. Abundant water for processing raw jute, because I tell you what kind of jute, raw jute is, what is the shape and size. Okay, just a minute. Jute plant, it is more than human size. It's a grass kind of thing. Okay, so just you can see, just a minute. Check, this is the size of jute. Do you see that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you can see the another one, jute yarn, or you can say this is the extract coming from there. So what we do, if you see the green one where the man is harvesting that, it is a kind of grass, you know, and the stem which you see, which is more than human height, okay, that is basically kept in water to, you can say, what do you say, decompose. Okay, so when it decomposes, the thread like of the thread type of thing in that stick, right, the flesh comes out, or you can say that pulp type of thing comes out from that one when you beat that jute in the water. So when you splash on that water, or then what happens, that the pulp comes out and that thread come, you know, remains in your hand. So when the thread is, remains in your hand, you get the thread which I just showed you in the next picture, right? So this is basically the jute. Okay. My grandfather, when I was small, I used to see the jute production in my village, and people used to make ropes, jute ropes, okay, for their you can say cot, the charpai. Okay, so yeah, so that was there. So this is jute, and basically of course cheap labor is another one thing, because Bihar, West Bengal, Bangladesh, all these highly populated areas, so here you get a lot of labor. Why? Because I told you the processing is labor intensive work. Okay, because you have to thrash, or you have to beat the jute in the water. So if you leave the you can say the bundle of jute in water for 3-4 days, after that fermentation takes place, decomposition takes place, and after that what happens, that the pulp comes out and the thread or the fiber remains in, you know, there. So after splashing in water, what you do, that everything comes out and comes clean, right? And after that we dry it for another, let's say, 3-4 days. When it is completely dry, you make bundle and you can keep with you. And then we had one hand spun, you can say the wheel type of thing. From there you can make the ropes, or you can say the string type of thing. Okay, and from there you can make plenty of things. So if you see the goods made of jute, so the bags, have you seen the jute bags?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so the sack and the jute bags, all these things are, you know, these are made of, and of course it is important these days, because it's now environment friendly. So people have to, people now going back, where is that, okay, to that portion, that way, and it has become quite you can say fashionable also these days. So here it says that supported by good network of railways, roadways, waterways to facilitate movement of raw material to the mills, abundance of water for processing raw material, cheap labor from West Bengal and adjoining state of Bihar, Odisha, Uttar Pradesh. Kolkata, as a large urban center, provides banking, insurance, and transport facilities for export of jute goods. So you have to understand that for any industry, if you want to, if government or anybody wants to grow in a particular industry, not only the raw material is required, you need skills, you need labors, you need machine, you need market, plus other things. Service industry is also required over there. What? Banking, insurance, transport. Okay, communication, good system of communication. Because of all these things, what happens that the production is speeds up, okay, and the distribution, then export, then marketing, everything speeds up with the help of all these you can say the supporting agencies, right? And these are the factors for the growth of any industry. So let's say if you talk about iron industry, then you need, of course, better transport system, then you need banking, insurance, communication. All these things are required for any industry. Okay, it is whether if you talk about software industry, just consider that why not in Patna, why not in any ABC city in the country, why only in Hyderabad or you can say Bangalore or Pune and all these things. So you have to understand that this is something where we need, which is not required to be near the raw material area. Okay, of course, in software industry, you don't need any raw material. So you need a skilled people. The skilled people can transfer anywhere. Okay, can travel anywhere. So that is one thing. Then you need good climatic condition also. Okay, because if it is very hot or something, of course, people would not like to work in that area. And people would not like to leave because it's quite grainy work. Right, then you need good transport system also. That means good airport. You can say software does not need to transport because it's not a good, but of course people travel a lot. So you need good network of, let's say, railway, or you can say the airports and all these things, so that the movement of people can be easy. So you see, if you talk about Silicon Valley in California, or you can say in Hyderabad or Bangalore, Pune, of course these have very good transport network. Then banking and other facilities are also there, right? So that makes the work easy, plus of course the government policies. So that is for every industry. Okay, so these are the factors for the growth of jute production or the jute industry. Given at page number 68, okay, first column, last paragraph. Now I'm coming to second column. Challenges faced by the industry include stiff competition in the international market from synthetic substitutes and from other competitors like Bangladesh, Brazil, Philippines, Egypt, Thailand. Okay, in these areas, of course, a lot of rain, and then water sources are good. Okay, temperature and other things, geographical conditions are also good. So these are the, you can say, potential, or you can say these are the competitors for India. Okay, so these are the challenges. Further, it says, however, the internal demand has been, of course, and the synthetic material, because synthetic material is waterproof, synthetic material is more durable, it doesn't decompose quickly, and naturally it poses a good big threat to the environment. That's a different thing. But okay, if you talk about jute and all, then you have to understand this way. Now you see, most of the things which what we pack our grains, or you can say the crops, mostly in plastic bags. Okay, because one thing is that it is light in weight, easy to handle. Because if you take a 100 kg jute bag, jute sack, that will weigh you around 3 to 4 kg. That means a capacity of a sack which can have 100 kg of wheat or rice, okay, that will weigh around 3 to 4 kg. So it's heavy, okay. But 100 kg plastic sack, or you can say the synthetic one, maybe around 50 gram or something. So naturally, if it is 4 kg weight of that sack, just if you fold it, how much space it will take, okay? It is not waterproof, okay? So those are the things. But the plastic sack, or the what we use in the modern days, naturally it is very easy to carry, light in weight, waterproof is also there, and cheap also, right? It doesn't decompose or doesn't get torn, and all these things happen. So because of that, what happens that synthetic material is more favored, or you can say, preferred, instead of this one, the jute one. All right. So, however, the internal demand has been on the increase due to the government policy of mandatory use of jute packaging. So, to grow or to support the jute industry, government has made some laws that it has to be in the jute packaging because so that the demand can pick up. Okay, to stimulate demand, the products need to be diversified. That means you have to be innovative and creative to make more and more use of jute in various products. Let's say if you make furniture from jute, that means that one, then the fabric, then bags, then many other things can be made. Okay, the curtains, jute curtain and all these things. That means not completely jute, but if you mix, let's say 20 or 30% jute with cotton, or you can say with the other things, naturally you will come up with a different design and different durability and all these things. Okay, so those things are important. So here the innovation, creativity, and the more you can say the political will is important here. Okay. So, to stimulate demand, the products need to be diversified. The main markets are US, Canada, Ghana, Saudi Arabia, UK, Australia. These are our main markets. The growing global concern for the environment-friendly biodegradable material has once again opened up the opportunity for jute products. So, naturally, people now have started going for jute bags and jute things because, you know, the microplastic, the havoc we have. Okay, wherever you go, doesn't matter the best beaches in the world. If you come in the sea water, you will see that the one plastic is coming towards another plastic poly bag or something is coming towards you. Or when you dip in the water, you will see that, okay, it's always there. I saw in many places, especially in nice beaches in Thailand also, I saw that in Malaysia also. So that means it has become a huge pollution everywhere. So, you know, it gives you a very disgusting feeling that, see, I came to such a nice, beautiful area and now in the water we find the plastic. I don't know if that plastic was used for what, right? And it is now freely floating in the seawater. So, and it will not decompose. So, it may go in the fish stomach or whale stomach or anything that will further create problem for them. Okay. So, because of the global concern, naturally people are now moving towards the jute one. All right, now we are talking about another industry, which is sugar industry. Okay, so India stands second as a world producer of sugar, but occupies the first place in the production of gud and khansari. So, you know, gud, you understand gud, everybody?
No.
Really? Jaggery?
Yeah,
gud. Okay, and khansari is also similar type of thing. All right, so the raw material used in this industry is bulky and has in haulage its sucrose content reduces. So basically what is that? Sugar comes from sugar cane. Have you seen sugar cane in your life, girls?
Yes.
Where? In the market or
India?
In the picture?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, in India you have seen, that's good. Okay, so you must have seen that it's quite you know, long one. It's a big stick, you know, maybe having a inch diameter, right, with maybe 5 feet or 4 feet tall or something like that. Okay, this is how it goes on. So you can understand that it's a heavy material. So the raw material used in this is bulky because in haulage its sucrose content also reduces. So if it is transported from one place to another, what happens? That evaporation takes place. Okay, that means the water content from that sugar cane, okay, starts evaporating, and because of that, what happens? That when it is pressed in the machine, you get less sugar juice, right? Okay, so in that case, what happens? That you get less sugar, so you need to have the sugar industry, or you can say the sugar mills, close to the sugar cane producing area. Okay, sugar cane transport. Okay, so that is important, and just a minute. right, so I just give you some pictures, one or two pictures for your better understanding. Where did it go? Okay, I don't know where it went. Anyway, okay, so you need to be close to, that means the sugar mills need to be close to the sugar cane producing area, so that the transportation should not reduce the sucrose in that, or you can say the sugar content in that sugar cane. The mills are located in Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat, Punjab, Haryana and Madhya Pradesh. So you can see that which belt, mostly Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, all these areas, okay. Mostly in the western side and not in eastern side India. Then 60% mills are in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. This industry is seasonal in nature, so it is ideally suited to the cooperative sector, because you do not get sugarcane every all the year around. So in that case, you need to be you can say a seasonal thing is there, so cooperative sector work over there. And why can you explain why this is so? So why cooperative sector? So what happens that when you get the raw material throughout the year, then of course you can produce the final product can come anytime. But here what happens, since it is seasonal, so what cooperative sector does is that whoever is contributing whatever amount of sugar cane, okay, they get money according to that, right? So this is how it works. Further it says that in recent year there is a tendency for the mills to shift and concentrate in southern and western. This question comes very often, that why Uttar Pradesh and all these are the major sugarcane producing areas, but Maharashtra and other states mills are more. Why? So here it says that mills to shift and concentrate in southern and western states, especially in Maharashtra. This is because the cane produced here has a higher sucrose content. Why? Because of the climatic condition. The cooler climate also ensures a longer crushing season. That means you do not need to crush immediately it comes to the mill. Okay, why in North India what happens basically, that because of hot weather, if you don't crush it quickly, naturally it will dry. So you will have less sugar content. So there will be a loss. But in the moderate climate, or you can say the moist climate, it remains fresh for many days, right? So the sucrose content will be more over there. The cooler climate also ensures a longer crushing season. Moreover, the cooperatives are more successful in these states. So that is why the cooperative sector is more successful, because the farmers grow sugarcane over there, and they load that sugarcane in the tractors or the trucks. Okay, they go to the sugar industry, the sugar mill, where the whole truck is weighed. Okay, is weighed, and after that weighing takes place, that you get to know that how much sugar cane you have brought, right? Okay, and based on that, of course, you are paid accordingly, right? So this is how it's done. So major challenges here, of course, every industry has its own challenges, whether it is cotton, iron, or any industry, okay? Because somebody's gain is somebody's loss, or somebody's loss is somebody's gain, okay? And everything has two sides. So if it is something is good, naturally some challenges are also there. So major challenges include the seasonal nature of the industry, old and inefficient methods of production, transport delay in reaching cane to factories, and the need to maximize the use of bagasse. What is this? After crushing or extracting juice, you get that pulp, that is useless. Okay, so in that case, you will see that a sugar mill which crushes millions of tons of sugar cane, and they get the juice, and after that, what happens to that bagasse? Because the tractor, the farmer sells that sugar cane to the mill owner, and after that they are paid, and that is none of their business, right? That means the you can say the waste material is the problem of that sugar mill owner. So that sugar mill, how it is going to handle? So if we have nearby paper mill with a lot of research and development, what we can do is that we can make handmade paper, or we can make paper also, one thing. Second one is that we can have, let's say, thermal power energy sector also located nearby, so that the after extraction of juice, that bagasse can be used instead of coal, right? And you can generate electricity, that can also be done. Or you can say, since it is a bio, these are my ideas, okay, none of these things is written here, but then also, since these are the biodegradable areas, so what we can do is that we can make ethanol, that is also a kind of source of fuel. Okay, another one is that since it is a biodegradable areas product, so if we decompose it, we can extract methane gas, right? And that methane gas can be supplied to, let's say, the power sector or to the houses. Okay, these are some of the uses. But of course, you need coordination between various agencies. Otherwise, what happens? The sugar mill owners, you know, are tired of handling that bagasse because it's a huge quantity, right? And they don't know that what to do and how with this waste material. So if governments, of course, naturally government might be doing, because see, India is such a big country, and India is a sweet loving country. That means, I'm not talking about India is a sweet country, that means we love sweets, right? Okay, it's not like the American that, or the other thing that they drink black coffee without tea or sugar and something, right? So we make mithai, and everywhere the chai should be there with the sugar and all. So in that case, you can understand the consumption level in the country, right? If the consumption level is so high, naturally you have to produce. So if we produce, the amount of the waste material, you can say the bagasse, will be huge. So how the government handles that, this is also a kind of case study, or you can say something to know. So it can be sent to the paper industry, it can be sent to further another industry where ethanol or ethanol can be produced from that after fermentation and all. That ethanol is a kind of alcohol, okay? So that if you mix with petrol or diesel for 10% or 5%, naturally you will have another substitute of the, you can say, that energy sector. That means, let's say, out of 100 liter, if you use in that 100 liter, if you use 95 liter of petrol and 5 to 10 liters of, let's say, this ethanol, which you produce from the sugarcane bagasse, so this 10 kg or 5 liters of ethanol will substitute that 5 liter of, or the 10 liters of petrol. So if you multiply in a bigger amount, you will find that, of course, millions of liters of petrol or diesel or the petroleum, we do not need to import from other countries if we use this ethanol, okay, as one of the substitutes or the mixing of in petrol or diesel, right? So these are some of the ways to handle this bagasse. So this is also not a completely waste material, it can be further used, so this also has value. All right, so these were some of the ways to handle this. Okay, now we are on another sector, another type of industry. So we have studied about agro-based industries. There we saw that we have cotton, then we have jute, then we have sugar, okay, sugar industry. So these were the three basic you can say industries based on agriculture. Now we are moving towards mineral based industries, okay? So I will finish page number 69. After that we'll see. Okay, so let's say we are talking about mineral based. So industries that use minerals and metals as raw material are called mineral based industries. So one more question, what is meant by mineral based industry? You can write down, okay? Industries that use minerals and metals as raw material are called mineral based industries. So similar thing, or you can write in agro based industries also, right? So industries that use agricultural product as their raw material are called agro based industries. So can you name some industries that would fall in that category? Of course, we know that. Okay, so I'm at page number 69. So the most basic and most important industry is iron and steel industry. So it says the iron and steel industry is the basic industry since all the other industries, heavy, medium, and light, depend on it for their machinery. Okay, so machinery are being mostly made of these things, the iron only. So steel is needed to manufacture a variety of engineering goods, construction material, defense equipment, the medical, telephonic, and scientific equipment also, and a variety of consumer goods. Okay, so if you look around in your room where you are sitting, you can figure out that how many things are made of or the uses iron, okay, as one of their parts of the components. So that is the thing. Now it says production and consumption of steel is often regarded as the index of country's development. So that means a country which uses more iron product. Okay, they are those countries are considered developed countries. Why? Because how? What is? Let's say there is a poor country which where the houses are made of mud. Okay, there is no iron part in that. The roof, or you can say, is made of, let's say, the grass and the bamboo and all these things. So in that case, no, in that case also no iron. So naturally, a house, or you can say in a society, most of the houses are made of mud and the grass and other things, right? So in that case, that society is quite undeveloped, or you can say the underdeveloped society, right? So that is why the consumption of electricity, the consumption of iron and steel, these are one of the parameters to judge the country's development. So here it says that production and consumption of steel is often regarded in the index of country's development. Iron and steel is a heavy industry because all the raw materials as well as the finished goods are heavy and bulky, entailing heavy transport cost. Okay, if you see the flyovers and all the transport projects in Japan, okay, the stations, elevated stations, then railway tracks, then you can see the Shinkansen or the bullet train tracks, or the pillars, or the bridges, or the network highway going expressway, all these things. You can just visualize that how much iron is used to develop the infrastructure, or you can say the transport infrastructure in the country, right? So you can understand that. On top of that, you can also visualize that iron is not found in Japan. That means iron ore is not, one of the resources in Japan. So mostly these resources are imported either from Indonesia, India, China, okay, these countries, the neighboring countries. Because if you see here, these are some of the countries, or you can say in Brazil also it comes. So these are the countries where iron and ore is exported to other countries. Coal in Japan comes from Australia, India. It comes from Indonesia. Okay, because these are the neighboring countries. Okay, in terms of not neighboring, but of course in terms of, you can say, sea trade, these are quite close countries to Japan, right? Especially China, India, and all. Okay, further it says, where I am? So iron ore, coking coal, and limestone are required in the ratio of approximately 4:2:1. Okay, so iron ore 4 units, coking coal 2 units, limestone 1 unit. Okay, some quantities of manganese are also required to harden the steel. So what does the manganese do in this iron industry? It makes it hard. Okay, where should the steel plants be ideally located? So if you see the ratio, naturally it should be close to ratio 4, that means unit 4, right? That means unit 4 belongs to iron ore, not for manganese or let's say the coking coal or limestone. So remember that the finished product also needs an efficient transport network for their distribution to the market and consumers. So you can understand that, okay, since the raw material is very close to in this area, so I should locate my industry here. But you have to understand that what about the transport of the finished goods? It has to reach the market. If it doesn't reach the market easily and cost efficiently, then it is going to be further a problem, right? So you have to understand that if the seaports are near my factory, okay, or my plant, or the market, the domestic market is good enough, and the people have the purchasing power to buy iron, why will they buy iron? For construction of houses, or let's say the housing company makes houses and people buy those houses, right? This is how the machinery, the development, for various development project also iron is needed. So whether the government has funds, people have money to buy these products, so of course you have to see that also. So good market, port, then transport facilities, these are also some of the important factors, okay, apart from the availability of raw material. Okay, further it says that in 2019, with 111 million tons of crude steel production, India ranked second among the world crude steel producer. Crude steel means basically we make the slabs and you can say the iron bars and all this, that is called crude steel product. It is the largest producer of sponge iron. What is a sponge iron? That you can, you know, you are science students, so you can figure out that what is a sponge iron later. In 2019, per capita consumption of finished steel in the country was only around 74.3 kg per annum against the world average 229 kg. So you can understand that what is our condition in terms of iron steel consumption. Okay, so why this happens? Because India being relatively a poor country, people, when they construct their houses, they do not use much steel. Okay, this is one thing. Then government's projects are not so extensive to use steel. That is one, another one. Okay, these are some of the things. Okay, industries, not many industries come up as compared to let's say Russia or UK and other countries, developed countries. So because in industry also you need a lot of iron steel things. Okay, so if these things are not growing in the country, naturally the steel consumption will be low in the country. Okay, so you can see here one table is given that in 2015-16 this was the production. In 2019-20 we have 102 million ton only, okay, as compared to 15 and 16 it was 106, right, 120. So it is going down. Why is it going down? That also we have to understand. What are the other factors? Did we get any substitute of iron? Maybe yes, because iron ore is naturally a non-renewable resource, so people may find the substitute. One thing, right, that means hard plastic and maybe some different material. So because of that also the consumption of iron is going down, so low in India. Okay, so okay, many steel plants are smaller, have electric furnaces, use steel scrap and sponge iron. They have re-rollers and that use steel ingots as well. They produce mild and alloy steel of a given specification. So after mixing two or three metals, you make alloys, and that alloys is used for the, let's say, the car wheel or the vehicle wheels and all these things. Okay, and we have small scale industries, iron scale industry also. So here we have the flow chart, that process of manufacture of a steel blast furnace where it is melted. So transport of raw material to the plant, iron is melted, limestone is fluxing material which is added, slag is removed, that means waste material is removed, coke is burned to heat the ore. Okay, then molten material poured in the molds called pigs, right? Then comes steel making. Pig iron is further purified by melting and oxidizing. The impurities, manganese, nickel, chromium are added. So remember these three minerals again: manganese, nickel, chromium. Okay, these are the you can say the minerals which are added further, right? And rolling, pressing, casting and forging is done in production of iron. Okay, so you can see the iron steel, next page, page number 70. Iron and steel factories, or you can say the plants in India, in mostly concentrated in Chota Nagpur belt, in West Bengal, then Jharkhand, then Odisha, then Chhattisgarh, in this area, because that is very high in iron ore production, right? So I leave you now here. And then we will continue in the next class. That's okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's already 9:45, huh? Chalo. Okay. See you later next week. Huh?
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you,
bye,
sir.
Bye, bye.